Love and marriage, love and marriage, they go together like a horse and carriage. This I'll tell you, brother, you can't have one without the other. Love and marriage, love and marriage, it's an institute you can't disparage. Ask the local gentry, and they will say it's elementary. Try, try, try to separate them, it's an illusion. Try, 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 and you will only come to this conclusion. Love and marriage, love and marriage, they go together like the horse and carriage. Dad was told by mother, you can't have one, you can't have none, you can't have one without the other.
Hello and welcome back to our food webinars. This is Dr. Judy Morgan from Clayton Veterinary Associates. And today is the seventh in our food webinar series. And today is also the day that our Cavalier puppies left us and went to their new home. So that video is the last puppy video that you're going to see for a while. So today we are going to continue moving forward. If this is your first time with us, I would invite you to go back and review webinars 1 through 6. They're on youtube.com/Dr. Judy Morgan. And we've covered a variety of subjects, and I know that a lot of people have been following along, and it's been really nice because I've been getting new clients that have come into the office that have already watched all the webinars up to this point, and it makes the consults so much easier to do because people whip out their iPhones because everybody's more tech savvy than I am, and they say, oh, is this what I'm supposed to be feeding? And it's pretty cool. Alrighty, so let's get started. Food is the Foundation of Life, Part 7. I can't believe we're on 7. Today we are going to discuss chi tonics, and it's true, you are what you eat, so let's all eat healthy. And so we're talking about feeding real foods, fresh fruits and vegetables, fresh meats and whole grains, preferably locally sourced, organically grown, and the stuff that's really healthy for us, things that are not processed. And we're still talking about using different pet food formulations. So whether you're using dry, semi-moist, refrigerated, canned, home-cooked, raw, doesn't really matter. You still can follow the basics as far as whether you're using yin tonics, which were cooling and moisturizing, or yang tonics, which were warming and drying, or today we're going to talk about qi tonics. So what is qi and what are qi tonics? So qi is the vital energy or life force. It regulates our spiritual, mental, emotional, and physical imbalance. And it's influenced by the opposing forces of yin and yang. So the white and black symbol for yin and yang, there's always a little bit of yang within the yin and a little bit of yin within the yang. And so that's why we have the small circle of the opposite color inside each part of the yin and yang. Okay, so how do we get qi? Where does it come from? Well, there's jing qi, and that's the qi we're born with, and it's stored in our kidneys. There's a Chinese saying that we will all live to be 100 years old if we take good care of our kidneys and if we're born with good jing qi. So, you know, in the case of a dog or a cat, they're certainly not going to live to be 100 years old, and not that many people live to be 100 years because we do things to damage that qi. So we want to take care of what we're born with, and then we want to add to that as we move on. So where do we get that qi besides what we're born with? There's qing qi. And that's the qi of the universe. And we gather that through our lungs by breathing. We bring in fresh air, hopefully, not the pollutants that surround us. And we bring in good light and good energy from the universe. And that's our qing qi. And we add that to the jing qi that we were born with. And then there's gu qi. And gu qi is probably the most important thing. And that's the qi from the food that we eat. And that's the whole purpose of this entire webinar series, because we want to make sure that we receive and make good Gucci so that we will live to be 100 years old, or in the case of our dogs, to live to be 20 years old, or cats, close to 30 years old. So we want to feed really high quality products so that we can get the most out of the chi that we have and the chi that we continue to make. So where do we use that chi? We use it, all of our organs use it for different things. So there's kidney chi. The kidney chi is responsible for cleansing the body and supporting bones and growth and supports memory and hearing. So we start to develop arthritis if we don't take good care of our bodies and we don't eat healthy, because we're using up that kidney chi. And when our kidney chi starts to get weaker as we age, our memory gets worse, our hearing gets worse, and our bones start to deteriorate. For most women, that means osteoporosis, and for many people, it means arthritis if we haven't taken good care of our kidney chi. Liver chi. Liver is responsible for storing blood. It supports the tendons and ligaments, and the liver is responsible for eyes and vision. So when we see red eyes, then that means something is also going on in the liver, whether it's that there's a stagnation or, you know, things are not filtering correctly, or we're filtering a lot of toxins. We see cataracts in older dogs, and one of the ways that we support old dogs that are starting to develop cataracts is by putting them on milk thistle. Milk thistle is an herbal that helps support the liver, helps the liver to regenerate, and helps keeps the eyes healthy, so it can actually slow the production and maturation of cataracts. So, but anytime you have an eye problem, you need to look at the liver. So when I have an animal come in that is showing red eyes, painful eyes, I'm usually going to recommend doing lab work to see what their liver is doing, because very, very commonly the two will be connected. Okay, spleen chi. So the spleen, from a Chinese medicine perspective, is not the same organ that we have in the Western medicine perspective. When we think of the spleen from a Western medicine perspective, it's kind of an organ that we can live without. And people say to me all the time, oh geez, my dog had a splenectomy, now he can't digest his food, what's he going to do? What happens to his spleen chi? Spleen chi, from a Chinese medicine perspective, is more the chi of digestion. So it's responsible for the manufacture of nutrient chi from the food that we eat. It supports muscles, and it holds fluids and organs in the body. So it holds the blood in the blood vessels, and it holds body parts in. So one of the things, for instance, in cows that give birth and really strain and strain, and they're weak older cows, they'll actually prolapse their uterus, which means they spit the uterus out along with the calf. So that's a weak spleen chi. The spleen is responsible for holding things within the body. So the spleen is probably the most important organ next to the kidneys as far as a Chinese medicine perspective goes, because if we don't have healthy spleen chi, we are not going to manufacture any nutrient chi, and we're going to die. We're going to be weak because we're not making good nutrition. So we need to feed that spleen the things that it likes, and we need to have good healthy food for the spleen to manufacture that nutrient chi. Otherwise our muscles get weak. Think about dogs, animals, people that have a really poor diet, don't exercise, don't support their muscles and bones and joints, and what happens? They get flabby, their muscles get weak, and they have nothing to support themselves with. So the spleen chi is very, very important. Lung chi. Our lungs are responsible for sending fluids down from the body to the kidneys. They're responsible for respiration, voice strength, and the lungs actually also control sweating. So one of the things that we see in horses in Florida is something called anhidrosis. It's the inability to sweat, and we need to support that lung chi, keep it moist. The lungs do not like to be dry. They don't like to be hot. They actually like to be moist. So we need to help control that. Animals that are getting older, that are starting to lose their voice a little bit. People, think about an old person, harder to hear them. Their voice becomes raspy. It's not as strong. So that's what we use our lung chi for. stomach qi, responsible for digesting food. And so this goes along more with the Western perspective of what we think of as digestion. We think about food going into our stomach, being digested, being sent down to the intestines. But from a Chinese medicine perspective, the stomach is just the vessel that holds the food. The spleen qi is actually what is responsible for digesting and making good nutrition for us. Heart qi, responsible for transporting blood and controlling emotions. And why does the heart control the emotions? The heart, if it doesn't have good, healthy blood and doesn't transport the blood to the brain, we get crazy. We don't have enough blood. We can't control our emotions. The heart is responsible for joy and laughing and happiness. And if we don't have enough blood and we're not transporting that blood to the brain, then we get sad and we can't control those emotions. We might have anger outbursts, but we don't have that happy joy that goes along with healthy heart qi. Okay, so what are the symptoms of weak qi? Weak kidney qi. So we said the kidneys are responsible for memory, hearing, and bones. So if the kidney qi is starting to get weak, we're going to have hind end weakness. The kidneys control the hind quarters, the back end of the body. So when old dogs start to get weaker, going down in the hind end, unable to get themselves up, one of the things that we'll look at is how do we strengthen that kidney qi? How do we get that hind end up? So, you know, it's not all the bones. Part of that's going to be muscle. So that's going to be the spleen that was responsible for the muscles. But a weak hind end that's getting arthritic, trouble getting up and down stairs, that sort of thing, that's going to be weak kidney qi. Loss of hearing. As we age, our hearing gets worse and worse. We have to shout more and more. I find that I'm having to scream a little bit louder at Hugh to get his attention lately. So, you know, kidney qi probably needs to be boosted a little bit. And then certainly older animals that are going into kidney failure. So you can definitely weaken your kidney qi if you're like that little hamster on the wheel that you just never stop, never stop, never stop. Go, 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 go. You will wear out your kidney qi pretty early, and you're not going to get 100 years if you keep running on that hamster wheel at an incredible pace. So sometimes it's good to slow down, and I should take my own advice. So weak liver qi. Liver qi doesn't necessarily get weak as much as it gets stagnant, and the qi gets blocked up and stuck inside the liver. And so that shows up as anger and frustration and emotional outbursts. And I find with myself, I know when my liver qi is getting a little stagnant because I just get really, really impatient. And if you kind of press right under your sternum between your rib cage there, it's like, you know, that's a little bit tender. And that's liver qi stagnation. So your eyes might get a little bit red. And we see this in dogs, particularly in dogs that are a wood personality, because wood is ruled by the liver and gallbladder. And so those are the dogs who are prone to those emotional outbursts. You know, they'll be fine. They'll be great. You know, you're petting them, and then, you know, you pet them in somewhere where they don't really like to be petted, and they're turning around and they're like, you know, I'm done with you. Go away. And so a lot of times we need to soothe the liver qi in these guys. So these aren't guys that necessarily have a qi deficiency. They don't necessarily need their qi boosted. They need their qi moved. All right, weak spleen qi. So this is the most important one. When your spleen is weak, you're going to have digestion issues. So you might have vomiting. You're definitely going to have diarrhea. You could have fluid buildup, because remember, the spleen is responsible for holding blood in the blood vessels. So if they're going to leak, then you get swollen ankles. You know, you sit too long on an airplane. You don't eat very well when you're on the airplane. When you go to get off of the airplane, you've got swollen ankles. Prolapse of the organs, we talked about. Incontinence, that's inability to hold urine in the body, inability to hold stool in the body. So when I see these old dogs who are starting to leak urine or starting to drop little poop balls as they're walking along, we need to strengthen the spleen qi. If you have a weak spleen qi, you will have fatigue and loss of appetite. The fatigue because the muscles are getting weak. You just don't have the energy to get up and get going. Think about people that have mono. They just want to lay in bed. They just can't get themselves going. Dogs with Cushing's disease. Cushing's disease, we see weak muscles. So those, and those guys also drink and urinate a lot. So they actually have a deficient spleen qi as well as a deficient kidney qi. Dogs with Cushing's disease have so many things that we need to boost and fix. They're like a kind of a disaster across the board as far as their qi. But the spleen qi is the most important. And when in doubt with anything, fix the spleen qi first, and then other things will start to fall in line. So this is the most important. So because the spleen qi is so important, that's why we're talking about food. We're talking about healthy food. We're talking about good food. Because if you don't give good food to this whole digestive process, everything else will fall apart. Okay, weak lung qi, we talked about this a little bit. So your voice will get weaker, spontaneous sweating or no sweating. In the horses, we get the no sweating down in Florida because the lungs get too hot and dry and they just can't produce that sweat that we need to. Spontaneous sweating. So think about women going through menopause. You wake up in the middle of the night just, oh my Lord, I'm drenched with sweat. I can't stand it. Because our lung qi is weak, and our lung qi is weak because we're having a yin deficiency. Women, as they get older, become yin deficient, so the body gets dry. There's not enough moisture. So our lungs become drier, and so we get spontaneous sweating. So, I mean, this is why I love Chinese medicine, because when you start to put all the puzzle pieces together, it makes perfect sense. So how are we going to fix that? Moisture, moisture, moisture. So, you know, when we're older, we need to eat things like tofu, which is cooling and moisturizing. That's why there's so many, and tofu is soy, so that's why there's so many of those supplements for menopausal women that include soy, you know, soy drinks, that sort of thing. And as our lung qi gets weaker, we also have breathlessness, so asthma. Going to get worse. You know, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease gets worse as our lung qi gets worse. And we see that a lot in horses, the COPD. So what do we have to do? We have to strengthen the lung qi, which means we need to make it moist. We need to make it cool. That's what the lungs want. It's not necessarily what other organs want, though. So weak stomach qi, vomiting, loss of appetite. Vomiting is actually rebellious stomach qi. That's qi going in the wrong direction. It's coming up instead of going down because the stomach's job is to push food down into the small and large intestines. So I like this little guy. He's just, I mean, this is how you feel with that weak stomach qi. Just, I just kind of feel bloated. I don't really want to eat anything, even though I haven't eaten all day. And then you do eat something and you feel like you've blown up like a tick, even though you ate a half a teaspoon of something. So we like to keep the stomach happy. Weak heart qi, our broken heart. So when the heart qi is weak, we see heart failure. We see Shen disturbance. That's what we talked about, that emotional disturbance. So the heart qi has to be happy and strong to keep our emotions in balance. And certainly with weak heart qi, we will get palpitations, irregular heartbeat. I know when I have had, you know, 3 or 4 days of insomnia, maybe eating too many comfort foods, then I start getting more of those palpitations. And that's kind of the wake-up call of, gee, you know, maybe I should sleep a little more. I should strengthen my heart qi. I should allow my body to rest, and I should feed my body better so that my heart is happier, and then my emotions won't be so drained either. So it all goes together. So what are symptoms of weak qi? How do we know that we or a pet has weak qi? So our tongue diagnosis, we talked about that when we were talking about yin and yang. So qi tends to be more yang because it's energy and it's fast moving. So if we have weak qi, we're going to have that pale tongue look more like the yin because we're going to have more yin. The tongue is going to be wet because, again, there's more yin. So there's sometimes too much moisture there. There will be no tone to the tongue, so it will just kind of drape across the teeth. I saw a great case of this the other day, and one of these days I'm actually going to get an iPhone so I can take pictures of these as I see them. This dog came in, he had a phenomenally great weak chi. His tongue just laid across his teeth and just kind of drooped out of his mouth, even when he had his mouth closed. All he had to do was lift the lips and you could see this tongue hanging there. And it just didn't have any tone to it. It was very floppy. And so a tongue may also be swollen because it's got moisture in, so it might actually have too much moisture in it. This picture, I couldn't find a great picture on the internet. This guy has a nice pale tongue. Doesn't have a ton of tone. It's kind of droopy, but it's actually fairly dry looking in this picture. So this is not a perfect, this is probably more of a yin deficiency than a weak chi in this particular guy. But one of the really big things for that weak chi is that there's just no tone to the tongue. It just kind of droops over. And I'm not talking about a dog who's panting necessarily, a dog who's just sitting there, you open up his mouth and you look and the tongue is just kind of laying there. Just looks very weak. Other symptoms of weak chi, lack of energy, fatigue, weakness, you know, sometimes the older dogs that just don't want to get up and go anywhere. But we can see this in young pets as well. If we have a weak jing chi, remember that's the chi that we're born with. So if we have, you know, for instance, a puppy mill dog who is born with a heart murmur and an umbilical hernia and luxating patellas, you know, he's born with a myriad of problems. He's probably already got, he does already have a weak jing chi. He's got bone problems already. He's got luxating patellas. The dogs that are born with bad hips, they already have kidney chi problems. That's a weak jing chi. So they're going to have less energy. You know, that's the puppy that lays there in the corner versus the other puppies who are racing around like maniacs. Geriatric pets definitely tend to have a weaker chi. They've used up a lot of their chi, particularly if they have been fed poor quality foods their entire life. Those guys are burning out their chi a lot faster than they're replacing it. So they tend to not live as long. Excuse me. And so with our geriatric pets, we're always going to need to support chi, keep them going, keep them moving. Okay, so how do we treat chi deficiencies? With chi tonic foods. So a chi tonic is basically, you know, all meats are going to be chi tonic. So we want to feed the meat according to energetics. So we can have a geriatric dog who is yin deficient and, you know, very dry. And so we still have to feed cooling foods. So you're going to pick your protein based on whether the dog is hot or cold. Beef, chicken, rabbit, lamb, and tripe, which is stomach, cow rumen, cow stomach, those are all really good chi tonics. So if I had a dog who was too hot, I would choose rabbit. If I had a dog who was too cold, I would choose lamb. This dog that I happened to see the other day that had the weak chi, that had the really floppy tongue, was actually a middle-aged dog who was very cold, so didn't have much energy. So we actually chose lamb as his protein. I told her she could rotate between lamb and chicken, and it was pretty funny because she was the one who whipped out her iPhone and had the great slide that we had up with the fire burning and all the yang tonics. And she said, "Oh, I get to choose from this list." So it was great. And if you're not sure if your dog's hot or cold, well, beef is pretty middle of the road. It's pretty neutral, so you can go there. Or you can alternate. You can say, well, you know, we're going to mix a little chicken and rabbit, or we'll, you know, mix some beef and some tripe and, you know, mix it up a little bit. If there's any thought at all that your dog is too hot, just avoid lamb. Like I said, I don't recommend lamb very often. This dog that came in the other day was one of the few that I've said, oh, you're actually allowed to have lamb. Lamb's also very expensive, whereas chicken is a very cheap protein. So if you had to pick between the two, you're probably going to go chicken anyway. So chi tonic foods that are grains, millet, corn, oats, brown rice, and long grain white rice, which the Chinese call it glutinous rice, but it's the one with all that sticky starch. And we're going to feed according to energetics. So if we have a dog who's too hot, we're going to choose millet because that's cooling. And if we have a dog who's too cold, we could go oats because that's warming. Brown rice is going to be a little more cooling. The white rice is going to be more warming. Corn's pretty neutral, pretty middle of the road. I'm not a huge, huge fan of corn, mostly because it's used way too much in dry dog foods as a protein source, and I just don't think that our dogs need all that corn. But I will say that the spleen really likes something like corn because it's neutral, it's easy to digest. So for spleen qi issues, corn can be not so bad. But again, I would not use it as my only grain source, and I would not go real heavy on corn. So you can pick between those. You can use mixes of those. I think brown rice is healthy and pretty safe. It's a little harder to digest than white rice would be. So if you have a very old geriatric dog that, for instance, is in kidney failure and the dog is cold and needs to be warmed up, a nice bowl of oatmeal that's, you know, pre-cooked and basically halfway digested, that's going to go a long way. Long grain white rice in that instance is also easy to digest and nice and warming. One of the reasons we use boiled chicken and long grain white rice, or boiled hamburger and long grain white rice, for dogs with diarrhea is because it's easy to digest, it's warming, and if we think about the spleen, a weak spleen qi is going to be a spleen that's gotten cold and damp, so we've got diarrhea. The long grain white rice, the oats, the chicken, they're warming. They help stop things up. They feed that spleen and they're easy to digest. So that's why it works so well when we have dogs with diarrhea. Nobody ever, you know, thought about that in the traditional veterinary world, but that's why it works. Okay, qi tonic foods that are vegetables, fruits, and nuts. Pumpkin. This is one of the reasons pumpkin works so well for diarrhea cases or constipation cases. You know, an animal with constipation that's weak qi can't push the stool on through. So pumpkin helps. It's got fiber, but it's also a qi tonic. So it helps push things through. It also helps hold things in when the spleen qi is weak and we can't hold things in. Squash, sweet potato, yams. I use those very, very commonly in my recipes because they're qi tonics. They're good for energy. They're good for digestion. Easy to digest once they're cooked. And all of these should be fed cooked. Figs. We don't use figs very much, but you can chop up some figs. I think that around here they're much more common around Christmas time when we're making cookies and things. But you know, in other areas, like in California, I think they're available most of the year, and people eat a lot more of them than we do in this area. Lotus seed, a lot of people, and lychee, a lot of people who live near a Chinese market, those are really, really good things to feed. I don't feed them because we don't have easy access to those things. Shiitake mushrooms. Shiitake mushrooms, not only are they a good qi tonic, they're also a little bit draining for the body, and they are anti-cancer. So shiitake mushrooms would be a phenomenal thing to throw in just about every pot of stew that you're making. And there are mushroom supplements in either liquid form or in tablet form that you can get. A lot of people are now taking mushroom liquid or tablets to prevent cancer. And, you know, personally, I would just rather eat some nice, well-cooked shiitake mushrooms. I happen to like them, and you know, they're good in a lot of recipes. So that's, you know, a little anti-cancer tip. Okay, so how do we treat qi deficiencies? Well, we're going to use qi tonic foods, and we're going to feed the organ that is weak. So if you have a dog that's in heart failure, you should be feeding heart. So beef heart, chicken heart. For us, we go to the Amish market and we buy chicken hearts by the pound. We feed them raw. You can cook them. You can throw them in your stews. If you have an animal who's having problems with the liver, you should feed liver. We feed chicken liver. Calves liver would be phenomenal. It's just expensive. If you're feeding beef liver, you have to be a little bit more careful about where that beef is coming from, because remember, the liver is the organ that filters and detoxifies things, and it does end up storing a lot of the heavy metals and drugs. So you want to find liver that's from, you know, grass-fed, or you're going to have a hard time finding organic beef, but grass-fed, free-range, antibiotic-free, that sort of thing, if you're going to feed a lot of liver. Personally, I only feed liver a couple of times a week, because of some of the things that can be stored in liver. So we want to be careful that we don't overdo. Dogs that are in kidney failure, if you can find beef kidney, again, from antibiotic-free, hormone-free, blah, blah, blah. Kidney is phenomenal. The biggest problem with kidney, one, it's hard to find, so you probably need to go find a good butcher. Two, it stinks to high heavens when you cook it. I used to be married to a Scottish person, and so we used to get steak and kidney pie from the local Scottish deli, and it stinks when you cook it. So if you have a Scottish deli nearby, those guys have access to kidney because they use kidney a lot in what they cook, but it does stink. Stomach, which is tripe, easy to get. It's kind of a superfood, but you want to feed green tripe, not the white bleached, you know, purified tripe, because that doesn't do anything for us. But so if you have an animal with bowel problems, feeding tripe is great. One of the reasons it's so great is it has the natural beneficial bacteria attached to it. That's why we don't want all that stuff washed off, and that's why it smells so bad. But tripe is a great thing to feed. And then, you know, if you have animals with respiratory problems, coughing, asthma, feeding lung is a really good thing. And lung is actually very easy to find. It's in a lot of those fresh rolls, like the Pet Fresh and some of the fresh rolls that I've seen that are not refrigerated. And you can also find lamb's lung, sheep lung treats. That's pretty easy to find. I don't feed a lot of lung. I don't have dogs with lung problems. To me, you know, everybody has, if you've seen my blogs, everybody has their stopping point, and there's a couple stopping points for me. Lung is one of those things where I kind of go, ew. I don't know if you've ever felt fresh lung, but it's kind of spongy and kind of weird feeling. And tripe is a little bit of a stopping point for me because it just smells so bad, but I found a couple of sources that I can tolerate a little bit, so I do feed it once in a while to my guys, but I gotta tell you, it's smelly. Okay, so the spleen, the Chinese spleen, not the organ we associate with spleen, does not like cold and damp. So we have to keep the spleen warm and dry for it to be happy. So this is that balancing act that we talk about. If we have a dog that is a little too warm and dry, so we've got a yin deficient dog, we want to be careful that we don't go overboard and feed only yin tonics. You've got to balance it, because you'll make that spleen too cold, too damp, and then you're not going to digest things well, and those dogs are going to get weaker, and you're going to have problems. So you always need to have some qi tonics in there to keep things moving, keep things dried out a little bit. So make sure you're balancing those diets. So if we're getting too damp, so how are we too damp? We've got a very wet tongue. We may be dripping some water from the nose. We've got fluid buildup in the abdomen. We've got swollen ankles on dogs, cats, us, whatever. So here's how you drain damp. It's pretty simple. You can add alfalfa if you're feeding horses. You can, you know, do alfalfa sprouts if you're feeding dogs or yourself. Barley. Great, great, great. It's cooling, it's draining. So even though it's cooling for those dogs who are too hot, it is draining. So it's going to get rid of that damp. So I like barley a lot as part of my meals that when I'm home cooking. Celery. You can chop up a little bit of celery, throw it in your home cooked meal. Corn, we talked about, the spleen really likes that. A little bit of garlic. We had a little accident at our house this week. The mommy of the puppies went trolling through the kitchen, and when the cabinet was open, she got an entire garlic bulb, which contained about 12 cloves of garlic. Now that's way too much garlic for a 13-pound dog. So I do not recommend feeding garlic in any amount even close to that, because it actually is toxic when it's given in large amounts. So the puppies got weaned really fast because we didn't want all the garlic in the milk passing on to them. Mommy seems to be fine, but we didn't want to risk it. So a little bit of garlic, so garlic powder, really garlic, fresh garlic that's been crushed is actually the best. So feeding a half a clove a day or every other day, depending on the size of the dog, would be absolutely fine. Horseradish, I don't know how much dogs like horseradish, but regular radish, most dogs do like, and so you can grate that up. Kidney beans, make sure they're cooked. One of our dogs, if we feed her kidney beans, they come out the other end just like they go in. She just does not digest them. So be a little careful with those. Try them out a little bit at a time. A little bit of lemon or lemon juice is great for draining damp. So this is another one of those, you know, if you're thinking about yourself, you're on that airplane and you're going, oh, geez, you know, my ankles are all swollen. What am I going to do? Stop at the little kiosk in the airport and get a lemonade. It'll help drain that. Eat some celery. You know, when you stop and get your Bloody Mary, make sure you get a couple celery stalks put in it. Mushrooms, again, I love them. Turnips. Turnips are great mixed in with mashed potatoes, actually. So those are ways that we can drain damp if we are seeing that the animals are just starting to build up fluid. And so if you have a dog that's in heart failure and he's starting to get fluid in the lungs or fluid in the abdomen, these things are great. I have a question.
For shiitake mushrooms, is there a quantity that's safe for dogs?
Shiitake mushrooms, is there a quantity that's safe for dogs? I don't know that they're not safe in any quantity. I wouldn't go overboard. I mean, for the dogs, I mean, we have Cavaliers, so they're average 15 pounds. To throw a few mushrooms into each meal for them would not be a problem. And again, it's not something that I would feed every single day probably, but if I was mixing a big pot of stew, I would have no problem throwing a cup or two of mushrooms into a pot of stew.
And can barley cause yeasty ears and allergic warm dogs?
Can barley cause yeasty ears in allergic warm dogs? Only if your dog is allergic to barley, which would be fairly uncommon because they're draining. But they are also cool. Barley is also cooling. So I suppose you could have a dog who has a problem with barley and could have yeasty ears. And you might need something that's a little more drying. But I don't see many problems with dogs that are fed barley with their ears. I see more problems with corn and wheat and soy. Okay? Okay. Moving on. Okay. So to warm the spleen. So again, these are animals that, you know, they're too cold and we're getting diarrhea issues and we need to warm things up. We need to start holding things back into the body. So you can use venison, which is deer. Mutton, which is lamb, and those are probably pretty even. Venison's only slightly cooler than mutton. I have around here a lot of people hunt and want to know if they can use the venison that's in their freezer for their dogs. And in the winter, you can get away with a little bit depending on your dog, but if you have a hot dog, you're not going to be able to. Kidney is warming. Shrimp, not too many people feed shrimp to their dogs because it's expensive, but you can. Lobster. I actually have one woman. Dexter gets lobster. He's like the luckiest dog in the world. But not too many of us are going to do that, particularly with a huge crowd. But the next things on the list here are pretty easy to feed. So chives. You know, I grow chives in my garden. You can chop those up and throw them in your stew. They're going to be nice and warming without going overboard. Walnuts, a little bit of ground walnuts. They work really well for dogs that are having diarrhea issues. Cinnamon bark, you can certainly, you know, sprinkle some cinnamon in the food. Most of them like it. Cloves, nutmeg, dried ginger, any of those dried herbs, you know, those are warming. Can help the dogs that have arthritis. It's very interesting. Some arthritis dogs will be worse in hot, dry weather, and I would say the majority are worse in cold, damp weather. So this is one of the ways that we help warm those guys and make their arthritis feel better. A little bit of dried ginger, a little dried cinnamon sprinkled on their meal when you serve it. Really helps warm them and helps that cold, damp arthritis in the winter. So that's really good for those guys. And you can use any of these herbs. I mean, we grow basil and rosemary and thyme in our garden. So you can feed any of those things. And the ginger, you can use fresh ginger or dried ginger. And that's one of those kind of superfoods as well. So really the big key to the whole thing is balance. So even if your pet is too hot or too cold, you have to balance the diet so that you have some warm, some neutral, some cooling foods too much of any one thing is not good. You know, I've seen people that come in, they've done a little bit of research and know just enough to be a little bit off balance. And so they come in and they've got their dogs way, you know, feeding all hot foods. And so the dog is just so hot they can't stand themselves anymore. Or they're feeding all cooling foods because they know they have a hot dog. But then the spleen gets too damp and, it, you know, the muscles get weak and the skin starts to fall apart. So you've got to balance everything and make sure that you're using a little from this category, a little from this category, but make the main protein source is really where you're going to be most concerned with, whether it's, you know, going to be more warming or more cooling. But even so, mix that up a little bit. So pork is going to be more cooling, rabbit's going to be more cooling, fish is going to be colder for the most part. But, you know, there's a lot of dogs that can't survive on fish alone, so we need to put something in there to balance that a little bit. So what's next? Next, we are going to talk about blood tonics. Originally, I was going to do qi and blood tonics today and discovered that qi took up a lot more than I had originally bargained for. And I probably gave you an overwhelming amount of information and you're going, I'm going to have to read those slides about 600 more times before I even have half a clue. And I apologize that it is kind of confusing. You know, the big thing is, if you have a dog who has a weakness, whether it be kidney, heart, old, arthritic, hind end, just throw some qi tonics into their diet so that we start to help build them up a little bit, and still remembering your energetics of hot and cold as you're doing that. So we're going to talk about blood tonics next time. Who needs them? What are they? Why do we need them? And what foods contain them? And with that said, that is going to be 2 weeks from now, because next weekend is Labor Day weekend, and it's probably my last weekend at the shore, so I think that I should go enjoy it. So next weekend we're going to take off, and so then we'll be back on the 8th, and we will talk about blood tonics. So next weekend is our break. And we'll be back on the 8th, and those two chairs will be filled by Hugh and I. So, do we have any other questions, or is everybody totally confused?
No, we got a few more here.
Okay, we got questions.
If my dog has food allergy to chicken, will she be okay eating chicken giblets?
If my dog has food allergy to chicken, will she be okay eating chicken giblets? And the answer is probably yes. There are a lot of interactions between things, but I have for the most part found that dogs that are who are allergic to chicken meat are not necessarily allergic to chicken liver, chicken hearts, or duck or turkey. They don't seem to interact. So you may be able to get away with duck or turkey. And if you're worried about feeding chicken giblets, then go buy turkey giblets, because those, I can get those at the Amish market as well. Sometimes not quite as easy to find, but usually they have them when they're, I mean, they sell turkey all the time, so usually you can get those.
Okay. How do you incorporate fruit like berries and apples into a stew? Can you just cook it all together in the crock pot with all of your other ingredients?
How do you incorporate fruit like berries and apples when you're crock potting? Can you just throw it in the crock pot? I do. I throw apples, pears, berries, whatever I'm cooking right on in the crock pot. I happen to feed the Stella and Chewy's frozen raw a lot. And there's, I mean, when you look at the patties, there's these dark spots, which I used to think were mold, and they're blueberries. So you can mix it in, no problem. I make in the winter, I say I, Hugh makes in the winter, a really nice chicken and brown rice stew, and we put apples and pears in with that. If you think about it, you know, chicken and apples, applesauce, I mean, that goes together really well. So you can throw it into your stew. You can also incorporate your berries and fruit slices as treats for your dogs. The woman who just picked up one of the puppies, who adopted one of them, says that she uses frozen blueberries as treats for her dogs, and that's a wonderful treat. So you can cook them, you can feed them raw, it doesn't really matter.
Okay, one more. Does does pumpkin go both ways for both diarrhea and constipation?
Does pumpkin go both ways for diarrhea and constipation? You betcha. Pumpkin is just phenomenal. It just knows which way to go. The thing is, it's a chi tonic. So if the spleen is weak and you're having a diarrhea issue, it's going to help the spleen chi. So it's going to help digest foods better. And it has fiber. And we all know that, you know, fiber can help hold things together. We also know that fiber can help move things along, but part of the reason the pumpkin is working is because it's affecting the chi of the large intestine, so it gets the large intestine moving. I see tons and tons of cats with chronic constipation issues, particularly cats that are fed dry food. And so first thing is we have to get them off dry food. We all know I don't like dry food anyway, and cats should never be fed dry food. Cats with constipation issues really shouldn't be fed dry food because it's dry, so there's not any moisture to help things move through the bowel. There's not enough fiber to move things through the bowel. So I take those cats and I put them on canned food and I add some pumpkin to it, and cats love pumpkin. It's a little bit sweet, so they'll eat it no problem. I incorporate a lot of pumpkin. Our dogs get pumpkin. It's a superfood. It's right up there with sardines, and when we talk about blood tonics, you'll see why I like sardines so much. But pumpkin is really good, so it can be used for constipation or diarrhea. It's just good for good bowel health, good spleen health. Okay. So that's all the questions we have, and that wraps up another week. And so remember that you can go back for review of any of the food webinars by going to youtube.com/Dr. That's Dr. Judy Morgan. And so there will be 7 food webinars up there now. And going to try to label them a little bit better so that you know which one is which. But number one talked about reading ingredient labels. Number two talked about different formulations. Number three talked about making your own home cooked and raw diets. And then I think we might have talked about the energetics of pets and the energetics of foods, and now chi tonics. So there you go, in a nutshell. Have a great holiday weekend, and I'll see you in 2 weeks.
Thank you for joining us for our food webinar. Remember to follow us on all of our social media, on Facebook and Twitter, at ClaytonVetNJ. That's ClaytonVetNJ. Remember to visit our website as well for more information about how you can help your pet live a healthier lifestyle. Make sure you join us next week for the next installment of Dr. Morgan's Food Webinars.